We've been out here visiting these volcanoes of the Kermadec arc for the past 10 or 12 years, and over the course of that time we've been able to determine the size of these volcanoes, whether or not they're hydrothermally active, and indeed where these hydrothermal vents or hot springs are located on the sea floor. What we're endeavouring to do during the course of this cruise is to find out in much greater detail where exactly do these hydrothermal systems lie. And in order to achieve that, we're going to use some of the most sophisticated deep sea vehicles that we have currently available today in the world. Initially, we start off with the ship's multi-beam, and what that is, it sends out an acoustic ray of signals onto the seafloor, and that will map the surface of the seafloor in great detail, and in fact, it will map it to a resolution of about 25 meters. And that produces these wonderful maps you can see here of the volcanoes and structures that are occurring on the seafloor. We also tow behind the ship what is known as a magnetometer. So this is measuring the Earth's magnetic field on the seafloor. And each and every one of these things has a specific magnetic signal. Another tool is known as a CTD, which stands for conductivity, temperature, depth. And we fly this package very close to the seafloor, and we measure continuously what's happening in the seawater column. And so we can tell if there's any of this hot water, and we can find it in real time through the course of the survey over up and over a volcano. Another great piece of equipment that we have on board is known as TOCAM. This again comes from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, and it's a very sophisticated high-resolution digital camera that is flown between 3 and 4 meters above the seafloor. When we want to recover samples from the seafloor, as you might imagine, that's a very, very difficult task. Unless we're using manned submersibles or remotely operated vehicles, the only thing left for us to use is what we call sleds or dredges in some instances. So again, we can lower this down from the ship, we can identify specific targets on the seafloor, and we can recover some samples representative of that part of the seafloor and bring them up onto the ship.
These are some of the samples that we've recovered from the seafloor. In this particular case, we have a mineral called barite. It's very heavy, and you can see the crystals of barite in the sample. So we know that we're very, very close, or in fact, this represents hot springs on the seafloor. This is a different type of rock that's a representation of the silica that's in the fluids on the vent floor. And you can see all of these different textures here, which are commonly the result of microbial activity. Sometimes what we find down there is that we have these really iron-rich fluids, and they commonly precipitate a mineral called hematite. And you can see that here in this beautiful red colour. This is often very late in the history of the system, and this is also full of barite, so it's very heavy. So this piece is probably the most exciting piece that we've found thus far. And you might be able to see these very bright sort of brassy yellow colours in here. And this is a mineral called chalcopyrite, where much of the world's copper comes from. So this is telling us that the fluids here at some point were quite hot, probably hotter than 250, maybe as hot as 300 degrees. And if you look in here very, very carefully, you can see tiny little areas here where the fluid has flowed through the rock. So what I believe this to be is pieces of chimney that have fallen down, and they've sort of amalgamated and made what we call a breccia. So this represents an erosion, if you like, of the chimneys on the seafloor.
So the main piece of kit that we have on board that differentiates this expedition from any other expedition that's come to the Kermadec arc is the vehicle known as Sentry. It's a highly sophisticated autonomous underwater vehicle, which means it's not tethered to the ship, and it can be programmed on what to do on the seafloor. We tell it where to go, we tell it what to measure, it can fly 30 meters or so above the seafloor, it can hug the contours of the seafloor, it can tell us where the hydrothermal vents are, it can tell us what the magnetization of the rock is, it can tell us in acute detail what the topography is like down there. So it's a very, very effective tool, enabling us to bring all the pieces of information that we have from the other tools and to laying it out all in one map. As an example, if you look at one of these bathymetric maps derived from the ship, you can see the general outline of the volcano, you can see the boundaries of the caldera rim, you can see the cone in the middle, and so on. if you have a look at the surface-derived magnetic map for that volcano, the areas that are shaded blue show very clearly those areas which are low in their magnetization. That means almost certainly in these instances that we've had a lot of hot water pouring out in that particular area. So we can use this as a first order tool to locate where the hot water is being expelled on the seafloor. If you now look at the map that should have been derived from Sentry, which is flying only 30 meters above the seafloor, look at the difference in the detail of the magnetization, and you can see these so-called burn holes, these blue circles, if you like, on the map. Each and every one of those tells you where fluids have been flowing up through the top of the volcano. In the end, like most of these expeditions, when you have a number of professional people all working together, we've been able to pull it all off and to achieve all the objectives and the targets that we set out to do. And the legacy of this expedition is that we're going to have information that we can provide to various bodies, governments, so on, and indeed to our children for many years to come.